Okay, JSON and APIs. This is what I want to talk about. So what is JSON and what's an API? So I have prepared some quick slides. Please arrange them. Maybe you'll be my timekeeper. Once it's 15 minutes from now, please just stop me so I don't talk so much. Okay, what is JSON and what is an API? Let's go. I'm going back. Okay, let's start with an example. Suppose that you want to send an SMS online. I hope we all know that we can customize sending of SMS. For example, if I want to send SMS, I want to broadcast SMS to everybody in this group now, and I want to customize the SMS to have probably Developers College as the sender. So you don't see the number that's sending message to you, you just want to have Developers College as the sender. I can do that. And to do that, I might need to call some applications, okay? Because that capability does not exist on my phone. I can't broadcast and change that, but there are some companies that provide what we call APIs, okay? So we just take it as API now because I'll still explain it. So they provide that application for me, and they will tell me, use this to send the SMS, okay? So now, in that application, they have a lot of functions. For those of us that already know programming, so we should know what function is. They have a lot of functions that can do different things, but the one I'm interested in is just to send SMS. So now they expose, I use the word expose, they expose that part of the application called send SMS to me, and they give me a format to use when I want to call it, and probably if I also want to be receiving SMS on that line also, they might give me a format to be receiving. So that format is what we want to talk about, right? I'll talk about it. But that application itself and what they exposed is what we refer to as API, okay? So now all I need to do is I'll call the application that they gave me, or maybe an endpoint or whatever it is. When I call it, it returns and delivers the messages to all of you in this group. So now, the question is, I don't need to bother about what they have done on that application, how they wrote it. I don't need to bother myself about it because it's none of my business. But all I know is that whenever I call that part of the application, it gives me and does the work I want it to do. So we are not concerned about the application. So that is the concept of APIs, right? So we just know that this application, whenever we call it, with a particular format, okay, like now, if you are writing a language in Java, there's a syntax to write the language. If you are writing in Pascal, there's a syntax, and we have learned that. So, but the whole thing is that I don't need to bother about whatever they are doing there, but they've given me a format to communicate with that part of the application. And whenever I communicate in that format, it does what I want. Okay, so that's the concept of API. But I'll still talk more about it. So let's go to JSON. So before we talk about JSON, there's something we need to know. They call it data serialization, because if I just go into JSON, you would get confused a bit. So what is data serialization? In Java, we learned how to create a class, okay? But what I'm showing you on the screen now, this object format is an employee class in C#, okay? Because in Java, you might ignore this get set, or use your getter and setter, the way I taught us to do that. So, but let's take this as a class. So a class that can allow you to instantiate an object that will have an ID, a name, and an address, okay? So now, if we have this class, this is in a definite structure. Now, if I want this class to communicate to something else, or I want to build an API that I will say, okay, whoever is calling me should have this structure of this class. It becomes difficult because I don't know whether the person that is calling me is going to be calling me using Python or PHP or Ruby or whatever other language that we have out there. So for me to be able to let everybody be able to use the most common or a standard way of communicating, I have to think about data serialization. So data serialization is just a process of converting this structured format of employee to a format that allows us to be able to share it, okay? And then it allows us to be able to share it across different platforms. Whoever is calling in Ruby can call, whoever is calling in other things can call, or if you are using other applications, you can call using different platforms. And whenever they need to recover the original structure back, they should be able to recover it. So that is the essence of data serialization. So when I have something like this, if I'm going to allow other people to be able to call it, I might convert it to this format. So that means whenever I convert it to this format, we call it serialization. And that is where the JSON format comes into play. You can see the reason here saying that the reason of serialization is finding some sort of universal format that can be easily shared across different applications. So this is where JSON format comes in. And what you are looking at here now is just a translation of your object, of your class, into JSON objects. You can see we have public int ID here. Here we just have ID in quotation mark, and you have the value. Because it's integer, the one does not have quotation mark. For the string, you have your string, and then you have the value. So JSON is the attribute value format. We'll learn more in the next slide. Okay, so what is JSON? Now that we know what data serialization is, then we need to talk about JSON. So JSON just means JavaScript Object Notation. For some of us that don't like JavaScript, with time you realize that in this world or in this programming line, you cannot survive without JavaScript. Let me not say it throughout anyway. So, but at least you need JavaScript one way or the other. So JSON means JavaScript Object Notation and is an open standard file format that allows data interchange, okay, using human readable text. When we say human readable text, you see that this JSON format could be readable to everybody. Anyone that does not even know programming, once he sees this, okay, we'll say, okay, yeah, this is an ID of one, yes. This is the name of the person, and this is the address. It stays in India. But if you give this object format to someone that does not know programming, you have created confusion, you know? So this is what we are trying to achieve through JSON, okay? And it also does what? It allows us to be able to store it and transmit the data consisting of what? Attribute and value pairs. Okay, this is an attribute. All the properties of the object or of the class. The customer or the employee must have a name, he must have an address, he must have an employee ID or something like a personnel number or something like that. So these are the attributes. You see them in bold. And then the values are in front. So we talked about attribute value pair. And we also have arrays and some data types like your string, your integer, and the rest. So these are examples of JSON. You can see. So anything from this bracket to this bracket is an object, okay? And so we have different objects or a list of objects in this diagram that we're looking at. And that's why we separate each object by comma or each items in the list by comma. Look at the one on the right here. This has an attribute of ID, name, price, tag, okay? And then you see that tag now has some other two content inside it. So in this case, when you see something like this, that means tag is an array. When you are representing an array, these are just your normal attributes there. So, but tag itself has some other sub-elements. So I taught us array in Java. So we should understand that concept. An array can have more than one item inside of it. So, but in JSON, you need to note your when to use this type of bracket and when to use this other type of bracket. You can see stock to as an object as warehouse and retail. Okay, so this is a hub, is an object, and inside the object there's a particular attribute that is an array, and it's in there. So as we go further, or as our instructor is going to teach us, he's going to talk more about JSON format. He's going to talk more about. Sorry, I need to check the chat now. It's not showing. Okay, so he's going to talk more about. About this in Node.js, and we can also read more about JSON and what it does. These are also some examples of a list of students, each student having each object representing each student information. This is Rizwan, this is Faria, and the rest of them. Okay, so we can read more about why we need JSON. I've already said it for data interchange. That's why we need JSON. Okay, and so API that I explained before just means application programming interface. So just like I explained, we want to send SMS. So we just did an SMS API that can help us broadcast SMS to everybody, probably in Sweden or in Nigeria or anywhere, can help us broadcast the message. But we don't know how they are broadcasting it. So that's not our concern. All we are interested in is that we could call them, probably in JSON format, and they can send it to what we want them to do. So that's the brief one I want to quickly talk about. I would leave the floor to Arinze to continue from here. Thank you very much. Is there any question? Any questions so far? No.
Okay. So the goal of the next couple of steps or classes will be taken is to build a REST API, that is an application interface. And what we are going to be building is a task manager. So what we're going to be using is a task manager. The keywords we'll probably be using, firstly, what we are building is an application interface. As the Silva described, we are going to be using JSON, which is our format for sending, or you can call it syntax for exchanging the data. Maybe not today, but later on, we're going to add a database. A database is basically like a store or a warehouse, if you can call it that. For example, when you use Facebook, your details are stored in a database, and there are different kinds of database. We'll talk about it probably in the next class, I think. To test our application, we'll be using a client app called Postman. What this basically does is we don't have the web application. That is, we don't have the front end, or you can say we don't have the Facebook website to test our application. So what we're going to be using is this to test our application. So basically, the calls you would have been doing, for example, when you're on Facebook and you put your username and your address, and then you click on login. What that login button does is to send a request to the server. So this guy would be creating our own login request, if you can put it like that. Yeah. So to start off, this is the last class we had, and just ask this. Sorry. One second, I need to take this. Have we all downloaded Postman? Do I move this? Okay. Okay, that's good. One person has downloaded it. Okay, so the first thing I'll be doing is to remove everything in this class. And if we recall the last class, I said that this is a module. For the class today, we are going to be using a module. We're going to be adding a module, and the module is called the Express. One second, please. So, what Express basically does is, what's this? What Express basically does for us is it's a web application framework for Node.js, and it's free. So you can actually use it if you want to build like single page applications or like front end applications. But for us, what we will be using it to do is to build our REST server. And it doesn't, if I do this, for example, this is how we are to import it. But this wouldn't work straight off the bat because we need to install, we need to add Express as a dependency. So to do that, you need to run npm install Express. You can also add this. So for example, if you do Node.js Express, I think it should be one of these ones. Okay, as you can see, this is how to add Express to your project. And when you run this, please, we can be following us and doing this so that it's easier. When we run this, if we go to our package.json file, we'll have something like this. So can we please confirm when we do that? I'd wait and just give everyone like 2 or 3 minutes to do it. Run npm install from your terminal. Run npm install express. Save that --. Save. Please let me get confirmation when anyone is able to do that. Okay, when somebody's done. So let's call this const express. Defining a constant variable express for the dependency. And if you remember from our last class, you know, like I said, Express is basically a web framework. And if you remember from our last class, we created something like this to So it was listening until we got the request from our web page. So let's try to create a skeleton for Express. So if we do something like this, Express. So for Express, we do something like const app is equals to. If you actually read about Express, they have a. Let me see if I can find the page. No, can ignore this. Yeah, so they have something like this, which is basically saying to start. Like creating the server. And okay, we won't use this syntax. This syntax is a bit old. I don't need this. Okay, let me just type it. So we have that, and then we can do something like app.listen, which is similar to what we had here to listen on this port. So we have like app.listen. Here we put the port. Let's make things a bit clean and define a variable to hold the value of our port. And then we'll put it like this port. It accepts app.listen takes two parameters. One is the port and the second is a function. So we can do and say console.log, which is basically print to the screen. So we know that our server prints to the terminal, so we know that our server is up on whatever port we passed. So if I run this the same way we ran our project the last time, so I do node.index.js, I have this server, and as you can see, it's not, the project doesn't end. So you just wait. We are not doing anything now. I just wanted to show you that, similar to what we had the last time, we have this. Does everyone, and then do we have questions? Or is it, does everyone understand what we have so far? Hello? Are we all on the same page? Have we?
Yeah, just trying to see if it works on our individual machines.
Okay, wait for a bit so that we're all on the same page.
So while we wait, the meeting goes off anytime. We have less than 10 minutes. We should not forget to just join back with the same link that we joined with previously. Thank you.
What's the status? Do we have everyone able to run this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other person, please? Please, let's make sure we are following and practically, not just listening. We're trying to replicate this on our local systems as well. Is there any other person? Are we having issues?
How do I terminate the?
Control C on Windows, I think Command C on Linux.
It's not giving me, I'm on a Mac.
Command C, I think. Did that work?
No, no, it didn't.
I don't remember.
Okay, I'll find.
I'll just quickly Google it. Yeah.
So just Command C. It's
Command C.
Let me Google.
It's not terminating. I'll find it, no problem.
Okay, do we have any other person that is able to successfully get this? For your Mac stuff, I still see it as comments. Please, can I get some response to anyone, or should I continue?
And continue, sir.
Okay. So now that we have our skeleton project, this is the node with Express. Next, I'm going to introduce the concept of routers in Express. Just give me a moment, I need to close this. Okay, so in what are routers? Routers are basically like an endpoint of a server. So I'm not sure if you guys have done some HTTP classes. So I think if you're aware of this get, post, put, and delete methods, these are basically HTTP methods, or I don't know, is it appropriate to call the methods, Silva?
Yes, for when you remember form actions in HTML.
Okay, yeah.
Form actions, we have the get and the post. I said we should not talk about the other one because it was not necessary at that point.
Okay.
Yeah.
So basically in Express, what we call routers, they help us to create, let's call them methods or functions, that we are able to handle this. So for example, let's say sometimes you go to a web application like facebook.com. I don't know why I always use Facebook, but facebook.com/your profile. Let's say your profile name is John. So facebook.com/John. And then on your, they serve you your personal profile, right? So what a router does is, it's going to listen to facebook.com right now is our local system. When it's what we call local host right now. Local host, since it's our server. And then we have this /John is the endpoint that we are going to create a router to handle whatever happens to whatever happens when someone calls /John. So in Express, how we deal with routers is, firstly, we need to do a constant. I think I'll put it here, constant, let's call it router, as equals to express.router. And this is not, this is basically how Express, which is the framework we are using, defines that we should define a router. So if you look at their documentation page, they say basically, if you want to create a router, this is what you should call, and then assign it to a variable. And then you're free to use the variable however you want. So for us, the first thing we are going to do is, let's do it like this, new express.router actually, sorry, yeah. So the first thing we're going to do is create a get, something to handle, let's call it a /John for now. Okay, so router, and we are using a get. So we are going to, if we put /John in here, /John, let's just call it /John. This takes the first parameter is the endpoint you want to use, and the next thing is an async function that takes in this way. This is request and response. So let's say anytime someone calls slash John, we just want to respond and say, hey, John, we'll do this. Everything the person sent is inside this method called request. We'll get into that in a bit. So we just do response. But status, the status is basically saying, is this request okay or not? Response dot something looks, give me a bit. Oh, something was missing here. Sorry. Response dot status dot send. And we are going to return a JSON object. Since we are creating a REST API, it's better we just return JSON for everything. And we are just going to say, message as hello John. Okay, so the last thing that is missing here is when you add a router, you need to register it with Express with your current app, so that this, because if you notice, we are doing an app.